mysterious and stupendous human mind started with observation and subjection to various environmental issues and affinities. It got a basic primary instinct. And it started observing the surroundings as well as being intentionally or unintentionally subjected to the surroundings and the consequences. It created a primary instinct. That is a temptation to share what it experienced and what is the output of the subjection. That is the first initial or inceptive temptation of human mind. In psychology, that is the initial temptation of the human mind based on observations and subjections. That temptation that was bifocused, either out of curiosity, which is based on getting benefits, or that type of curiosity which is extended to somebody to share the benefits for their welfare. So this type of sharing of one's own experiences based on observations and subjections, by which it tends to share or exhibit its inhibitions for either getting benefit, how to get benefit by means of directions, simplifications, guidances, instructions, directions, clarifications. These are all various levels of intellectual or informative support from an external source and rendering the same to other people. That started with communication. That instinct which tempts a person to move towards another for sharing of that instinctive inhibition to be converted into exhibition is known as communication. Starting from the basic biological instincts such as appetite, thirst, getting into the emotional understandings and exhibitions such as anger, affinity, joy and other things, and moreover hostility, fraternity, and various levels of the apprehension which they wanted to exhibit, they exhibited through communication. The communication, you know that there are two types of communications. One is a verbal communication, which are known as verbophonal communication. This is the history of communication. The verbophonal communications are just expositions of sound. And the sound on the basis of verb, we call in Alankara Shastra dhvani, the latent tone that is hidden. For example, ah, if you say ah, it may either be an exclamatory mark of a person's eudaimonia, happiness, or it may be also an exposition of sorrow. It may be even of pain. It may be of anxiety. It may be of a person's perplexity. It may be of a person's shock, surprise, suspense, and whatever may be the source. By just putting the word ah, we cannot just determine what the person is supposed to experience. So, based on the contextual surroundings, the dhvani or the tonic meter or the latent emotive faculty is being understood by the methodology of experiences and expressions by conversant authorities. So communication started with verbal and non-verbal. They are known as physical, non-verbal and verbal, they are known as physical gesticulations by means of sign language, body language. Thus communication started. Then communication started between two mutual persons. The Shastra say communication, Shadvidaha. There are six elements of communication. Six elements of communication. Yavaharane Shadvidaha. And it is approved by science also. One is content, Vishaya. Second is source, the Vakta. And third thing is form of communication, that is a Rupa. Fourth thing is Madhyamika or medium of communication. Fifth is destination or receptacle of communication, lakshya or shrota. Then the last thing is purpose or phala. So whatever the Shastra they have said about the definition of communication or the essential fragmental tools of communication, that has been endorsed by modern communication studies also. So that which has a content emanating from a source, having a form, also on the basis of a medium, reaching a destination for a purpose is known as communication. The communication is of several types. that is Saliloki. Then Somniloki, a person just bluffing in sleep, that is also a communication. There are imperfect communication, innate communication, perfect communication, precise communication, mass communication, Saliloki and internal communication, external communication, clan communication, commutative communication, clan communication, group communication, collective communication, and so on, so on. So these communication systems, starting with a group, it must reach a great amount of the measurement of the society. Specific communication, that is also there. Communication between God and an acharya is known as theo communication. Communication before a God made by a votary, it is known as theosophic communication. Communication between an acharya and shishya, preceptor and disciple, is known as disciplinic communication based on obedience. Then informative communication, instructive communication, subservient communication, suggestive communication, auditive communication, optical communication, which is now known as visual communication. There are different levels of communication based on the tools of communication, grades of communication, persons of communication, and the purpose and purpose of communication. So these communication skills, they started with the urge of a person to express himself. Starting from this level of an individual, a weak person of the society, to develop his urge for communication, ending with the urge of Paramatma to reveal himself in the form of Bhagavad Gita, everything is communicated. If you start thing in the form of the very lowest grade in which a person wants to exhibit his need for his benefit, it ends, where is the culmination? It ends with the reveal of the gospel of God. Either in the form of their own scriptures in different religions, the thirst of God, the craving of the God, in altruistic mentality for the upliftment of the whole of mankind, for a cosmopolitan common benefit, that is the culmination, saturation point. It may be a Quranic or a biblioethic, or it may be a scriptural synchronization, but it is a culmination point whereby a magnanimous, magno-cosmic spirit, it exhibits its urge for the benefit of a common mass, a great mass. So that is communication. In this communication, for common information system, CIS they used to say, common information system, in the development of a nation, awareness of citizens, we used to say, that is a primary criteria. We used to always admonish in our lectures regarding the national defense. We have always admonished as well as emphasized that a sleeping citizen is 100 times worse than a vigilant enemy of a country. So, creating awareness about the position of the nation, its defense status, economy, agriculture, political stability, education, social evils, infrastructure, rural and urban management systems, and various other tools of the social engineering, a person must be thoroughly made aware of. And that is the rule of the information system. Now there is the Information Broadcasting Ministry. That is the system which gives the impeccable information. We used to say in Sanskrit, known as pramana. What is pramana? What is perfect communication? It is pramana. It must have validity. It must not have the deficiencies of anudaya, nescience, samshaya, suspicion, viparyaya, malapprehension or misapprehension, vismriti, oblivion, vipralipsa, that is deception. So without having even the trace of nescience, misapprehension, oblivion, skepticism, as well as deception to mislead the public. That is the original, validated, genuine, imperishable, as well as immaculate source of information that is given by Shastra. What is Veda? Veda is a perfect source of information that is eternally applicable, relevant to all, that has no source of blemish. Likewise, even though eternity cannot be claimed to the modern new system or media system, except in eternity, in all other principles, the modern media system must be no longer or nowhere different than Vedas. It must be a different form of Vedas. It must be in the form of practical or pragmatic or mundane Vedas. So the media system, see, there are two things. Considering even worshipable things, commercializing the same thing for self-benefit is one end. Even normal things, they are deified. They are deified, glorified and divinified in the sacred drishti, what we call the preceptorial vision, of our ancestors, they used to sanctify and glorify each and every system. We used to worship the greatness and glory of each and every system. Wherein by we claim, there must be only one difference between the Vedas and modern media. That is eternal, whereas this thing is rotary and it is a recurring system which need not be eternal. Except from that, blemishlessness, uniformity, unanimity, and that type of vatsalya are concerned towards the society and its development in all other qualities. Barring the quality of eternity, the modern media must serve as a scripture. The Veda, Upper Veda, the Vedas is the disguise of modernization. These communications, when coming into the rule or group administration in the form of political systems, that is collective ruling, group ruling, clan ruling, and then it has resulted in different forms of crazy, which is known as crazy also sometimes, like democracy, plutocracy, autocracy, monarchy, etc. Then these ruling systems came into account. In order to create uniformity and unanimity in the society, in order to have the distribution of the wholesome information system of the structural and functional mechanism of the nation, the mass communication took a different gigantic shape, that is known as this type of media. So communication system developed into mass communication system, where irrespective of their groups, their base and sources, they must be binded with a common instinct on the basis of your province known as a nation, or a basis of your provincial attachment and liability as citizenship pertaining to a nation. A common binding instinct has been created, which has emerged in the form of mass communication systems. And this mass communication system, no doubt it has produced a lot of mediating sources. They are known as mediums. We used to say even, what is medium? Medium is serving as a bridge between the receptor and producer, capacitating and simplifying and nourishing the contents and quintessential message and essence of the producer's contents as well as the producer's intention or desire or destination to reach the particular person, producing his most possible infallible effect. That is known as medium. One who can reproduce, one who can serve as a bridge between two. Even in parapsychology, you know about medium. Whenever these people used to communicate with spirits, they used to communicate with medium. Whenever the spirits cannot communicate with these people directly, they used to possess a person who is amenable, amicable, flexible, adaptable, communicable, accommodable to these spirits. So immediately the spirits, they are believed to possess the person and talk on behalf of this thing. So that type of the person's anguish, the person is willing to hear, his anguish is non-transferable to that higher spirit. The higher spirit is giving that element, it is giving its response. See, there are two things. The prayers and blessings of God is served as a bridge for mutual benefit. What is the benefit for Jivatma, individual soul? The benefit is the blessings, benedictions of the Supreme. And what is the benediction meant for? What is the purpose of benediction for Supreme? That the worshipper or the votary, he must be benefited. This communication is made perfect by a preceptor. See, this prayers, they are very weak, so weak that they cannot reach a higher abode. And the answers to the prayers in the form of blessings, they are so potential that they cannot be assimilated by this inferior tool. So the superior tool's answers, they are multipotential and hyperpotential. And the questions made by the quest of the inferior soul, it is infrapotential and debilitant. And a person who boosts the potential value, who boosts the potential value of the person's prayers and also simplifies, disintegrates and dilutes to the taste and adaptability, the benediction of the God to cater to the needs of that receiver, the devotee, he is known as an acharya, he is a medium. Likewise, whenever there are two spirits communicating between each other, this primary communicating agent, he is so feeble so that he cannot reach the higher spirit. Higher spirit is so potential, it cannot reach, it serves as a medium. So this medium imbalances the disturbances or obstacles of distance, language, sturdity, obscurity, ambiguity, abstruseness, lack of transparency, all-through opaqueness, imperialism, governalism, monopoly, all of these factors, more than hundreds of factors, they hinder from attaining a proper source between two agents. And that we serve expressing the most reliable and trustworthy message. That is what we call as medium. And a group of varying systems of medium by which persons, by hearing, by studying, by learning, by visualization, by exploration, by browsing and various acts, they come into contact with different levels of tools. That is why it is known as media. And these types of media, by means of varieties of appreciations on various grounds, they came to be known as multimedia. See, media itself, that denotes, as per its plural sense, that there are different tools. But why to put this multi is a very simple question, but it has a lot of meaning inside. It is impregnated with a deep purpose. Media itself is a plural, which denotes that there are different levels. Then why to put this multi? Then that becomes tautology or pleonasm, he used to call it in English. So it is not so. They used to say there are different tools of media as well as different methodologies of media. So this media shows that there are different tools of media. And this multi shows that there are different methodologies of media. For example, if you say in visual communication as channels, TV, documentaries, etc., these type of things, they come under media, different levels of the same thing. Different levels of methodologies include internet access, EduSat, InfoSchool, e-learning. So these things are different methodologies for the same tools of optical communication or visual communication. So having different tools is known as media. That plural denotes it is having different tools for the same purpose. Different purposes are adopted by the same tool is coming under multi. To bring engineering by means of virtual learning and application, virtual training, it is applicable in medical science, in agriculture, in weather forecasting, etc. Then in astronomy, as well as in education by means of virtual learning. So several applications for the same tool and several tools for the same application, that has resulted in the pluralism of media and the prefix multi. So this multimedia has come from the URGE communication system. Now we are talking about two major principles which are known as the two I's. One is the ethics, second is the techniques. Upgradation of the functional supremacy is known as techniques. Upgradation of the structural and purportive mechanism is known as ethics. For example, if a person's standard, for example, I am speaking with this thing. So I am speaking with a loudspeaker, I am speaking with such an efficacious, sophisticated system. So I am adopting the techniques. And if I speak something wrong, misleading the society, self-praisal, or flattery, or wrong information, or pulling the person towards my sector by means of non-essential, non-parliamentary, irrelevant, and immoral methodologies of approach and accentuation, then I am misusing this technology or technical provisions, and I am ethically degraded. So, if you serve with an effective tool, you are technically perfect. And if your service is oriented with the benefit for others, long-running benefit for others, orienting towards the person's eternal as well as realized benefit, then I become ethically perfect. Somebody used to say, the basic question of ethics, what is ethics? Ethics is like an orbit to the planet. Just as we have access to a planet for self-rotation, just as you have an orbit for its rotation round its connective systems as well as its central axis. Ethics is a person's orbit. And we can clearly understand the benefit of ethics as they have clearly mentioned. The benefit of ethics, what is the benefit of ethics? Appraisal from the society, appreciation, reputation, promotion, upgradation, opulential status, then post-designation and other things, nothing like that. The real benefit of ethics is having the satisfaction that we are leading an ethical life and nothing else. And persons who are morally upgraded they are satisfied that they are ethical, and that is more than even giving the kingdom of heaven as well as the earth in that time. And whatever you say, that may not be practically, pragmatically, that may not be relevant, because we see non-ethical people serving and seems to be deserving, and ethical people being trampled under the titanic feet of misfortune. So, this type of ethics gives contentment to mind. Only in upper grade of mind, only in hi-fi mind, this society is a hi-fi technology. It is high-end technology. Likewise, in hi-fi mind, in hi-fi nobility, the person gets happiness. He gets contentment. He gets the satisfaction. He gets the complacence and tranquility by being ethical, practicing ethical, and whatever the thing that he procures by non-ethical measures, he totally ignores those things. He totally ignores those things, and any benefit from other things, he will not be able to relish. It is just like that, the inbuilt system of a herbivorous animal like cow to be exposed towards meat consumption. The person cannot go for any non-ethical practice because it is carved inside the DNA and gene standard of a person, and it is not caused by any external surroundings. So unless a person is taught, trained, tamed, and tuned by means of this type of explanation in his impressionable age itself, he cannot be convinced, he cannot be comforted and consoled by any explanation or elucidation or justification to go into the path of ethics. All the other things are just eyewash and lip service ceremonies. It cannot come for rescue. So ethical standards, there are two types of ethical standards. One is a reasonable ethical standard. Second is absolute ethical standard. Absolute ethical standard we used to see in this type of exaggerations in the stories of Harichandra, then Ramayana, in mythological characters. And in fairy tales and fable tales, you might have read about this type of ethical frameworks, which are impracticable and unimaginable in normal life. So that is a type of reasonable ethical standard, in which we may gain some profit, in which we can lead a reasonable life, but still we can think that we can not attain these benefits at the cost of sacrificing the benefits of the other person, leeching the person, or serving as a parasitical element, serving as a leeching agent and parasitical element on the other noble and innocent members of the society. So it is known as reasonable ethics. We can practice at any time reasonable ethics, in which even though we are benefited from a person, we contribute something as a token or as a repayment for the benefit, and we can lead a very good life. So this technical upgradation, now we know the technical upgradation by which everybody, mass communication, I told, mass communication is a very small word. We used to say about the insufficiency of words and word power, we used to say the word big is smaller than the word small. We used to say word big is smaller than the small. Shabda shakti asambhava, so says the Tarka Shastra. So words cannot denote anything. This is a mass communication. Mass is a small word. See, for your information, you might have known, in the year 1969, when the first man landed on moon, it was simultaneously seen by 600 millions of people at that time. So that is known as mass communication. It reached. So there are three things. One, landing on moon is a mega Herculean task. So that created an anxiety and expectation between the people. It has become info-sensational. That has become info-sensational. And second thing is, it is also the cradle level of the communication system of that time. So adding both of the spices together, communication system itself is a new network. That too, landing on a moon is a Herculean and arduous task. So that has created such a wave on the minds of the people that they must go for seeing those things. So lot of people, 600 millions of people, they watch. And the impact on society, that is what we must understand. So techniques make people to understand more, or more people to understand. There are levels of these things. More people to understand, and more to understand for the people. That is the techniques. And the benefit is caused only by the ethics. So more accessibility, more adaptability is made by technical upgradation. And the real value benefit, reaching more people, benefiting more people, is ethical standard. And reaching more people, or being adapted by more people, is technical standard. So these things are serving as two eyes for the media system. So the ethical systems can be governed by the ethical technicians. and the technical system can be governed by techno-technicians. So the techno-technicians, while governing with each and every system, they form the, there are three systems, that is body, mind and spirit. In media, the hardware technicians, like those who are interested in the technical studies and practice of the sound system, visual effects, editing and other things, they deal with the body of media. And the dialects, production, cogency, and observation of the continuity and other things are done by the mind. They are known as mind technicians. And the spirit is the person who has framed the screenplay and who has made the characters to speak their hearts out and who has directed the principles by which each and every emotions are personified in the forms of motions, movement and notions. So that person forms the spirit. So God gives you form, then gives you the tool of mind and spirit. Likewise, the creators in media industry, the technicians, the technocrats, they create the body of media. For example, a paper, a composer, a printer, he is body. And a person who does the alignment and putting these things, proof correction, he deals with the mind. The person who frames the messages and checks its vitality, validity, necessity, emergency, rarity, scarcity, adaptability to the society, that person is a spirit. He is a vivifier of that media. So vivifier of the media, promoter of this media, and a carving architect of the media with the external source. These three people, they comprise the creation system of any type of media. Print media, electronic media, mega media, digital media, mass media, hyper media, nova media, lot of media they have come. With hyperlinks, they used to deal with hypermedia. Digital electronics, association with media, that they have become digital media. And print media is very well known. Electronic media is there. Whatever may be the source, it is vivified by a spirit. Then it is activated and animated by a mind. Then it is carved and covered by a body. And this type of ethical system must be governed by an ethical technician. That is, must reach or not, because it governs, it creates sensation in the society. Society is full of, society need not be considered, it need not be considered as a generalized structure or configuration. There are swarm of bees, battalion of soldiers and flock of sheep, various type of elements are there in the society. They may not take things in the same manner. For example, when they telecasted, first released the news of the world wars in the form of War of the Worlds in the year 1938, there was a series which was very clearly expositioned by the media of that time in the year 1938, War of the Worlds, that has created a very great havoc in the society. How it has created? It has created hysteria. It has created hysteria in the society, and the persons, those who envisioned that War of the Worlds, the Holocaust of the war, the mass destruction, and the annihilation and bombardment of these atomic bombs and the other explosives and various other armaments that have been used, these people, even though they are known of wars and their consequences, but still envisioning something, you know that there is an accident will cause wound will cause bleeding, bleeding will cause somebody to find, these things are known. But practical subjection with perceptibility and proximity, practical subjection, proximity, intimacy. Knowing about an accident and knowing about the consequences of an accident as a knower with a cognitive skill, that gives you lesser impression. And then if you just see a person in proximity experiencing the same thing, that is an additive to your emotional upgradation or explosion. The same thing bombards if the person is very intimate, in intimacy. Self-subjection, you know that you will be fainted totally. So these levels, and what is the level of media? The media creates identity of subjection, proximity and intimacy. See, in persons, we must clearly understand, if there is some sort of abnormality in a particular area, we are just broadcasting, telecasting or printing the same thing. Why it creates sensation? Because in lower level caliber of human psychology, the psychologist and psychoanalyst, they used to say, the person develops an identity, forgetting this distinct identity of the self. What he must get is a cognitive standard that he is understanding about an accident or a war. But crossing that, overruling that limitation that he is a knower and that is a thing happening at a distance, by means of the methodology of projection or magnification or repetitive projection of the same thing in media or big size of photographs and catchy words and lot of other methodologies which are meant for these mass selling technologies and mass advancement or mass circulation techniques which are adopted by these media people that creates in low psychic impacts. A level of understanding more than cognitive understanding, that is intimate, proximate and subjection, as if the person is subjected to that incident, or somebody related or somebody intimate is that. So it created hysteria. When this war of the girls was first propagated to the public, that of public, more than 23% of the common society readers and observers of the media, they went into totally psychically impaired, schizophrenic, hyper-eccentric, hysteric in nature. That has created a very mass, colossal psycho-degradation in the society. Then only these norms of filtering messages and controlling the measures of messages, lot of these messages, these things are known as, there are two levels of these things are there. One is a pernicious manipulation of media, second is innocuous manipulation of media. While dealing with media, we have to understand three things. One is media liberty or media democracy, media liberalism and media manipulation. These three things are the three major pivots or the pillars of media industry. So in this media manipulation, the innocuous manipulation in hiding things, what are the manipulation techniques? One is to shadow some events, to prevent some events to come out, one. And to create fallacious, boosting sensational messages about something. And magnifying things more than what they are really bounded to be. So these things are known as manipulation systems. And also some level of what we call taratamya, discrimination and disparity. Even if a thing is understood to be wrong, and even if it is to be balanced, equal level of balancing is not properly given. For example, if there is a wrong news, fallacious news, and if it is to be, fallacious news spreads like forest fire. If it is to be reinstated with the real genuine message to be reincorporated, that must be given at least thrice the value of sensational emotion so that it can compensate the character assassination or the apprehensive assassination of the society. It must be given at least thrice, it must be given a potential missile, and at least twice, at least equal reference must be given. But these type of fallacious expositions, giving a predominant view in the media, and as well as the rectification things being projected infinitesimally somewhere in the corner, that is unjustifiable. These type of things are known as media manipulations, in which the person taking into, there are two types of things. One is protecting the media and being protected from media. Then the public or blocks of power or agencies of power through either democracy in the form of political authorities, either the authorities of investigation, justice and executive in the form of bureaucracy and other systems of management, or in the other systems of plutocracy where the industries and the other people with their influential, opulential status, they trample upon the neck of the press people to expose their liberty, to discharge their duties for the welfare of the public. There the public, they must form an union, or they must realize that these people, media people, are servers of them, and they must protest against those type of trampling agents to safeguard the validity and genuinity of the media which serves them with a motherly care. And when media overrules and takes advantage of its liberty, media freedom, and serves to a particular community, clan or particular variety of the society by means of political support or backed by any other agents like power, wealth and other ugly heads of the society like community, like language or any other discriminative basis, then we must take measures that we must be protected by some other agents, agencies of our union, agency of your democratic right, that we must be saved from media instead of saving the media. So we must have the checks and balances of two things. One, to save the media from their opposing agents, to be saved from media when media becomes an opposing agent to our democratic rights and principles. So it is a very vast subject on various areas. Security for media, we must know, lot of journalists, they are prevented from writing some incidents. Lot of journalists, they were fired. Lot of journalists, they were arrested, they were harassed, they were controlled. Lot of things we used to hear, both the extremes we used to hear. And in tabloid journalism, harassing the people, then open or transparent or latent or clandestine blackmailing and trading, various systems are there in yellow journalism and tabloid journalism. So both of the things, they exist in the society. And the integral awareness, the committed awareness, the efficacious, functional, productive awareness of the society and the vigilant members of the society only can create a system wherein by the media is also well protected and people also will be protected from media if they are overruled. So media, you see, it creates everything, especially whatever an acharya he tells here in a mic, the same acharya is in TV fame. If that person claims something, that will reach more people. Because whatever, even an educated person, see, education has nothing to do with refinement. Education and refinement never will coexist. Even we say that most of the people, education, how can education bring renaissance into the society? If a person, if a thief is taught science and technicalities, then he will do scientific planning and he will do technical robbery. If a robbery is taught science and technology, then what he will do? Instead of just piercing with a knife, he will handle the same AK-47 or something else. So changing the mentality of a person, upgrading the proclivity status of a person by realization and understanding, that is far beyond education. Education is a source of information, it's a collection of information being tutored by a master inside a closed ambience of an auditorium or inside a school classroom, which is just vomited in the examination, forgotten the next second itself. So this type of education system cannot produce any development in morale and ethical upgradation. Ethical upgradation must be fed with the maternal lactic status that must deeply penetrate into the intravenous system, which must be nourished by a vigilant father, must be guided by an able and meticulous preceptor. So it is in the hands of the domestic system and an acharya seva, a preceptorial intervention, to create this type of ethical and moral system. The school-going students can never get any sort of ethical benefits. So these type of various levels of the media that we have, even a person, anybody can get any fame, and fame and capability, they never coexist. A capable person may be defamed or totally out of the range of fame, and vice versa. So these people, they get into popularity, preventing the real people or the real systems to come out. So unless these people, these vigilant people, for example, you cannot do the things what you do here at Kerala and West Bengal. In spite of the systems of religious understanding being different, even though communist in nature, the level of understanding and accessibility, for example, here the cinema is there, cinema industry is there. The amount of money that they spend for cinema, the amount of the hero worship and craze that these people are having, the amount of money that they meet from the industry, there's a repetitive, repetitive visual interest and subjection, and the never-ending perpetual craze towards the media industry. It is not there in other countries. They do also a lot of this appreciation is there, but the level of appreciation and involvement is entirely different. That does not go to the level of worship, transformation and incarnate adoption. These type of deification techniques are not there in the country. Because of their various, so they know what to appreciate and how to appreciate and how much to appreciate and how long to appreciate. This type of prudential applications are there. So this is what you call, apart from Irai Arul and this Thiru Arul, Guru Arul, etc. Now there is Thirai Arul. And whatever that is sponsored by this media, especially any commodity that is boosted for commercialization. And any person with any art or any type of projection that becomes the authority of the subject, that person becomes the authority of the discipline. And anything that becomes that is exposed in the media, that becomes the mark, that becomes the beacon light, that becomes the torch of the society. So it is not the fault. If there is somebody, see, it is our duty to utilize the emotions of the people. There are two types of people. One, to utilize the emotions of the people, degraded emotions of the people, to materialize those emotions for their upgradation and development. That is a cheap way, that is a cheap media, what we call. And to upgrade the emotions, that's what I told in yesterday's lecture, Annai and Angari. A shop will give anything you like, but your mother, she won't give anything you like. And if you like something, this is not salubrious, it is pernicious to you, then she will try her level best so that you will avoid it. And whatever that is salubrious to you, even though if it is not desired by you, she will stimulate the desire, and how much the possibility of compulsion she could make, and she will see that you are benefited by that. That is a motherly approach. Media is really such a sanctified position. It is not like that. It is a position of Brahma. It is a position of Vasishtha. It is a position of Vasishtha's position. It is a position of a Purohit. One who benefits others, he is known as Purohit. One who reveals knowledge, he is known as Vashishta. One who creates and gives form to things, he is known as Brahma. And if these things are there, very much we can just have this analogy, have this exemplification, having functional identity and similarity with the necessary frame, functional framework of the media industry. So if it efficaciously, infallibly, if it takes the duties and responsibilities and executes the same, it is no more, we cannot simply say that it is just a media, it is an industry. It is nowhere lesser than God. So it takes care of us. So it is Mata. It also admonishes us. It also wants us and leads us with rigidity. So it is Pita. It opens our eyes by giving information about this society. So it is Guru. So it reveals all of our problems. By properly putting the problems to proper ears, it gives a solution. So it is God. It is Mata, Pita, Guru and Deva. It has such a vast scope of functioning, but still being handled by simple and cheaper hands, it has been put to the level of demon and something lower than that. If it reaches the capable hand, if it reaches such a capable, such a caring, benevolent, brilliant, bright, magnanimous, cosmopolitan, altruistic hand, it serves something more than God. Because God himself is the first person in multimedia. He evinces his form in Vishwarupa Darshan Yoga. He narrated Bhagavad Gita. He 5 days he conducted crash courses in Pancharatra Agama. In Bhagavata, he conducted mass communication courses to lot of rishis in Naimisharanya. So mass communication, visual communication, then print communication, scriptural communication, then transformation and transmission lineage, everything what we have as a modern tool. The first multimedia head of the department, as well as the primordial authority of this media, is God himself. And irrespective of being God of any sect of worship, God revealed his form. He revealed his craving in the form of sound. He transformed and transmitted these things to reach impeccable lineages in the form of receptors and preceptors. So God is the first person of multimedia. And the last person of multimedia, if he does not reach the first person of multimedia, that type of multimedia is not multimedia, that's a multimedia. And that will have no purpose. So let us have this session as an introductory session, because most of the invitations that are printed and meant for the persons who participate and who come here as the guest speakers, those invitations are very safely kept inside my room. Then how people will come to know and they will participate in the function? So it is an excellent function, very idiotically organized. So when we organized the previous year's anniversary function, there were only 10 persons in the hall. When we organized the previous year's anniversary function, there were 10 persons in the hall, and one or two persons were the hall persons, caretakers, one or two persons maintaining the mic and other sound systems, and two or three persons just came inside just to see what is happening inside, whimsically, and two or three persons we came here to speak. So it was organized in such a very wonderfully quixotic way. Then I am of a person with a different approach. Then I told the next time, I am not convinced, next time the same topic we have to take in a broader sense, bringing more people, bringing effective audience. Just to fill this, you see, the number of people sitting here is lesser than the number of people, the concourse that is coming to hear my discourse in my residence. Daily I used to see a lot of people more than this. And it is not a crowd. Bringing crowd is not a greater job. Bringing effective and targeted audiences, I can bring a lot of people from Kanchipuram who are very well equipped in bhajana technology. So, but that is for some other thing, for Nama Sankirtana or something, that may be okay. It is not gap filling, space filling or room filling technology. It is targeted. It is principled. It is specific and focused. So I am not satisfied with this. And within a month, I wish that in a bigger auditorium, in a more wider auditorium, bringing lot of responsible, learning, ambitious, aspirant, skeptic, antagonist, conversant and stalwart authorities of the society we have to bring. And we have to bring also more speakers from various research institutes from parts of the country. And let me finish this introductory lecture, now sowing the seeds for a bigger ceremony, a richer ceremony within a month, reaching mass, I also told mass communication, reaching the masses through our speeches as well as our publications. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.
மீடியா வந்து அம்மா மாதிரி செயல்படணும், அங்காடி மாதிரி செயல்படக்கூடாது அப்படின்னு. எந்த ஒரு அங்காடியும் வந்து தன்னோட கஸ்டமர்ஸ் வந்து கம்பல் பண்ணி எதையும் வாங்க வைக்கிறதுல நினைக்கிறாங்க. சப்போஸ் ஒரு அங்காடி வந்து ஐஸ்கிரீம் இருக்கு, சாக்லேட் இருக்கு, திஸ் மை வியூ, தெரியல எந்த ஒரு கரெக்டும் தெரியல, இந்த ஸ்டாக்கிங் மை டவுட். நிறைய விஷயங்கள் இருக்கு, எதுவுமே வந்து இது நீங்கள் எல்லாத்தையும் இதெல்லாம் வாங்கியாங்கன்னு சொல்லி எது நமக்கு நல்லதோ அது மட்டும் தான் நம்ம எடுத்துக்கிறோம் அஸ் எ கன்சியூமர்ஸ். அப்படி அம்மா வந்து எந்த ஒரு எதிர்பார்ப்பும் இல்லாத தன்னோட பணியை செய்கிறவங்க. ஸோ அப்படி இருக்கும்போது மீடியா வந்து இப்போ ப்ரொஃபஷனாக எடுக்கும்போது அஸ் அ பிஸ்னஸ் மேஜர் மெயின் ஃபர்ஸ்ட் அப்ஜெக்டிவ் ஆஃப் அ பிஸ்னஸ் இஸ் டு சீ ப்ராஃபிட். ஸோ அப்படி இருக்கும்போது எத்திக்ஸ் மெயின்டைன் பண்ணி தான் பண்ணணும், அதை கண்டிப்பாக அதை தான் பண்ணணும். பட் ஹவு திஸ் வில் பி டிஃப்ரெண்ட் அங்காடி காமர் மீடியா இஸ் கிவிங் வாட் எவர் அவங்க கிடைக்கிற ப்ராடக்ட் எல்லாமே வந்து ரேப்பரிங் இட் ப்ராப்பர்லி கவரிங் இட் வித் ப்ராப்பர் டிசைன் கவர் எல்லாம் போட்டு ரேப் பண்ணி ஒரு இதுவாக பேக்கேஜ் அண்ட் ப்ரெசென்ட் இட் அண்ட் இட் இஸ் அப் டு அஸ் டு டிசைட் வெதர் வி வாண்ட் டு சீ இட், வி வாண்ட் டு பை த பேப்பர் ஆர் வி வாண்ட் டு ஸ்டார்ட் ஆன் தி டிவி ஆர் வாட் எவர் இட் இஸ் அப்படின்னு நான் நினைக்கிறேன்.
அப்சல்யூட்லி ப்ரோஹிபிட்டட். லைக் தேர் இஸ் அ டிஃபரன்ஸ் பிட்வீன் ஐஸ்கிரீம் அண்ட் ஹெராயின். ஹெராயின் இஸ் அப்சல்யூட்லி ப்ரோஹிபிட்டட். Ice cream is prohibited for people having tonsillitis, bronchitis, etc. And normally, the prohibition of ice cream is of two types. One is quantitative prohibition. You must not consume more ice creams. And second is circumstantial or climatic prohibitions. You must not take it in orders. Like whenever you have a depression, raining, cold climate, etc. And the third thing is relative prohibition. If a person is having respiratory problems like a phlegm, other things, etc., then far that is a person he is to be prohibited from ice cream. And the chocolate is also like that. If a person is having tooth decay, so these type of relative or selective or circumstantial types of prohibitions are there. But in many cases, if you take heroin, brown sugar, all of these things, etc., they will not come under these things. So I have already told there are three things: இன்னசன்ஸ், இக்னோரன்ஸ் அண்ட் டெம்டேஷன். இன்னசன்ஸ்னால் ஒருத்தருக்கு வந்து எது நல்லது கெட்டது அப்படிங்கிறத தெரியாத, அதை புரிஞ்சு கொள்ள முடியாத ஒரு பருவம். இக்னோரண்ட் அப்படின்னு சொன்னதுனால் டோட்டலாக அறியாமல் இருக்கிறது. இன்னசன்ஸ்னாலும் தெரிஞ்சுக்காமல் இருக்கிறது தான், இக்னோரண்ட்னாலும் தெரிஞ்சுக்காத இருக்கிறது தான். அச்சா அது மாதிரி இடத்துக்கு எக்ஸ்போஸ் ஆகாமல் இருக்கிறதுக்கு இக்னோரன்ஸ்னு பேர். எக்ஸ்போஸ் ஆனால் கூட அந்த சிச்சுவேஷன் அப்ரிஹெண்ட் பண்ண முடியாமல் இருக்கிறதுக்கு இன்னசென்ஸ் இருக்கு. ஸோ வென்எவர் பீயிங் எக்ஸ்போஸ்டு, தி இன்கேபபிலிட்டி ஆஃப் அப்ரஹென்ஷன் இஸ் நோன் அஸ் இன்னசென்ஸ். அண்ட் ஆப்பர்ச்சுனிட்டி ஆஃப் எக்ஸ்போசர் ஹஸ் நாட் பீன் கிராண்டட் ஃபார் விச் எ பர்சன் ரிமைன்ஸ் இக்னோரண்ட். அப்புறம் எ பர்சன் இஸ் ஸ்டப்பான் ஆர் பிரின்சிபிள் அப்படின்னு நினைக்கிறது தட் பிகம்ஸ் தி இம்ப்ரெக்னபிள் அண்ட் ஸ்ட்ராங் நேச்சர் ஆஃப் எ பர்சன் ஈவன் தோ ஹி நோஸ் he is subjected to that exposure, everything, etc. The person is having such a staunch control that he is totally against it. That is known as, it is known as a healthy dogmatism by which a person is staunch and principled, ruling in front of him. And the way it is going to be. If those who are having that ruling behavior, that is where makkalude innocence and ignorance and temptation market panna kudada, temptation vandu, even though the persons who are knowing that it is wrong, if there is the possibility of a person's either apprehensive or applicative ambiguity, that is known as temptation. Temptation comes to a person, temptation occurs to a person where he is having either apprehensive or functional ambiguity. The person clearly knows that it is wrong, it is going to bring some sort of this thing. See, he immediately, for touching fire, nobody can relish touching fire. Yeah, because that has instantaneous effect. See, that is what we call sukaramba, sukamadhyama, sukanta, dukkaramba, dukkamadhyama, dukkanta. Things like gambling and drinking, they start with happiness or comfort. They proceed with happiness and comfort, but end in misery. And things like surgery, chikitsa, they start with pain and discomfort. They proceed with discomfort, but they end in your salubrity and perfection. And that creates you easiness. Likewise, if you touch fire, as immediately it hurts, nobody will tempt, have the temptation to touch fire. While in those things which have some sort of a pseudo-eudaimonic or pseudo-exultant status, in psychology they used to call it as pseudo-exultant status, in which it is wrong, it is going to dilapidate your moral status, degrade your position and also your surroundings, but that which is tastier. Just as we see lot of medicines and good herbs being bitter in taste, we are having lot of slow killing and instant killing poisons which are sweeter in taste. That is known as prakriya vaiparitya. In Sanskrit it is known as prakriya vaiparitya. So if all good giving things are sweeter and if all these evil elements are bitter in taste, then there is no work for your dignity or status of your intellect. You can consume whatever you are having the sweetness, and you can do anything, you can relinquish anything that is bitter. Then what is the work of your intellect and power of discretion? And what is the greatness of your adoption patience? So that is why it has been mismatched. Your sense of sacrifice, your sense of prudence has been elevated to a level. In spite of being bitter, you must be tuned to develop taste towards consuming something which is good for you. In spite of being sweet, being very much applicable and admirable to your taste buds, still if it is bad to your conscience and to your development or by your spiritual empowerment, you have to relinquish those things. So apart from there is a difference between ice cream and heroin. Heroin is absolutely prohibited. Ice cream is prohibited for people having tonsillitis, bronchitis, etc. And normally, the prohibition of ice cream is of two types. One is quantitative prohibition. You must not consume more ice creams. And second is circumstantial or climatic prohibitions. You must not take it in orders. Like whenever you have a depression, raining, cold climate, etc. And the third thing is relative prohibition. If a person is having respiratory problems like a phlegm, other things, etc., then for that the person is to be prohibited from ice cream. And the chocolates also like that, if a person is having tooth decay. So these type of relative or selective or circumstantial types of prohibitions are there. But if you take heroin, brown sugar, all of these things, etc., they will not come under these things. So I have already told, there are three things: innocence, ignorance and temptation. இன்னசென்ஸ்னா ஒருத்தருக்கு வந்து எது நல்லது கெட்டது அப்படிங்கிறத தெரியாத, அதை புரிஞ்சு கொள்ள முடியாத ஒரு பருவம். இக்னரண்ட் அப்படின்னு சொன்னதுனால் டோட்டலாக அறியாமல் இருக்கிறது. இன்னசென்ஸ்னாலும் தெரிஞ்சுக்காமல் இருக்கிறது தான், இக்னரண்ட்னாலும் தெரிஞ்சுக்காத இருக்கிறது தான். அச்சா, அது மாதிரி இடத்துக்கு எக்ஸ்போஸ் ஆகாமல் இருக்கிறதுக்கு இக்னோரன்ஸ்னு பேர். எக்ஸ்போஸ் ஆனாலும் கூட அந்த சுச்சுவேஷன் அப்ரிஹெண்ட் பண்ண முடியாமல் இருக்கிறதுக்கு இன்னசென்ஸ்னு பேர். ஸோ வென்எவர் பீயிங் எக்ஸ்போஸ்டு, the incapability of apprehension is known as innocence, and an opportunity of exposure has not been granted for which a person remains ignorant. Appra a person is stubborn or principled abdina nagatha, that becomes the impregnable and staunch nature of a person. Even though he knows he is subjected to that exposure, everything, etc., the person is having such a staunch control that he is totally against it. That is known as, it is known as a healthy dogmatism, by which a person is staunch and principled, ruling from the other side. If those who are having that ruling behavior, that is where makkalude innocence and ignorance and temptation market panna kudada. Temptation vandu, even though the persons who are knowing that it is wrong, if there is the possibility of a person's either apprehensive or applicative ambiguity, that is known as temptation. Temptation comes to a person. Temptation occurs to a person where he is having either apprehensive or functional ambiguity. The person clearly knows that it is wrong, it is going to bring some sort of this thing. See, immediately for touching fire, nobody can relish touching fire. Yeah, because that has instantaneous effect. See, that is what we call sukarambha, sukamadhyama, sukanta, dukkarambha, dukkamadhyama, dukkanta. Things like gambling and drinking, they start with happiness or comfort. They proceed with happiness and comfort, but end in misery. And things like surgery, chikitsa, they start with pain and discomfort. They proceed with discomfort, but they end in your salubrity and perfection. And that creates you easiness. Likewise, if you touch fire, as immediately it hurts, nobody will have the temptation to touch fire. While in those things which have some sort of a pseudo-eudaimonic or pseudo-exultant status. In psychology, they used to call it as pseudo-exultant status, in which it is wrong, it is going to dilapidate your moral status, degrade your position and also your surroundings, but that which is tastier. Just as we see lot of medicines and good herbs being bitter in taste, we are having lot of slow killing and instant killing poisons which are sweeter in taste. That is known as prakriya vaiparitya. In Sanskrit it is known as prakriya vaiparitya. So if all good giving things are sweeter and if all these evil elements are bitter in taste, then there is no work for your dignity or status of your intellect. You can consume whatever you are having the sweetness, and you can do anything, you can relinquish anything that is bitter. Then what is the work of your intellect and power of discretion? And what is the greatness of your adoption patience? So that is why it has been mismatched. Your sense of sacrifice, your sense of prudence has been elevated to the level. In spite of being bitter, you must be tuned to develop taste towards consuming something which is good for you. In spite of being sweet, being very much applicable and admirable to your taste buds, still if it is bad to your conscience and to your development or by your spiritual empowerment, you have to relinquish those things. So apart from bitterness and sweetness, you have to go into the core of that. So these three values are there. Whatever you see, for example, somebody asks me, if something is misleading, then if somebody seeing Ramayana or reading Ramayana, if they used to abduct somebody else's wife, then does it mean that Ramayana is misleading? Is there any possibility? But he asks the question that on reading Ramayana, if a person follows the principle of Ravana, that abduction of somebody's women, so he is pretty, he is being done by Ravana. If somebody practices Ravana, is it the malfunctioning, or if it is it the misuse, or is it the mistake and the error of Ramayana and its maker? Is he, can we hold the person, the creator of Ramayana, as responsible? Then it has been clearly answered, the projection. What is the work of a writer? To project characters and characteristic principles and consequences. There are three things projected. One is kathapatra. Then patra vishaya, vishaya phala. That is the work of media people. You have to project three things. One is kathapatra. Second is patra guna or patra vishaya, and third thing is vishaya phala or guna phala. What are all the characters? And what are all the characters and their functional standards? And what are the consequences of their functional standards? This is the thing. So in which Rama is projected. In projection also, there are two types of projections. There are two types of projections. Where we reject somebody and where we inject somebody. Where we emphasize morale, that is known as injective projection, and where we reject people, that is known as rejective projection. And Ravana is a character of rejective projection in Ramayana, and Rama is a character of injective projection in Ramayana. So a person who is doing the abduction, he had 9 heads more than you and he lost everything. That is the moral of Ramayana, and practicing abduction from Ramayana is unimaginable. Likewise, person see somebody saw this Shaktiman, and it is a fantasy of a person's external imagination to see or to create and to envision characters which can do things which human beings crave to do or which they cannot do or which they want or dream to do. That is known as fantasy. Fact and fantasy. Yel unarvu, mikku unarvu, or sirappu unarvu, we used to say in Tamil. So you want to fly, you cannot fly. You create characters which can fly and you get the happiness that you are flying like an angel with a characteristic identity, with a functional identity, with a type of functional absorption with the character at the time of your seeing. You are degraded and you are just amalgamated with the character and its functional state. If somebody is saying Shaktiman, just they can enjoy. Somebody that did like Shaktiman and one boy died or something, it came in paper. So it is the malfunction of this. There are two things. If any mistake occurs, is it the mistake of the other end or the producing end? That is the question of Rajesh. There are some areas in which we are clearly presenting something and somebody idiotically or unguidedly or misguidedly, if they practice something, if somebody is seeing with the Shaktiman, the purpose of Shaktiman is not to make people jump from their terraces or from the 9th floor or something else. And that is the idiocy of one or two people. That cannot contribute anything towards the responsibility of the person. But there are some areas in which, for example, people can say that even if somebody practices drug making or illicit liquor making or arak making, manufacturing and bottling and other things, we can clearly say that you have your own knowledge. Will you touch fire? Will you touch fire? Will you drink hydrochloric acid? Will you drink H2SO4? You won't drink that. So we cannot just say to the society, young society, they are prudent, they are knowledgeable, they are educated. Then they must develop an idea. They are clearly aware that the liquor will totally spoil their intestinal liver system. So they must be prevented from drinking. It is not though. So even though they are not being affected by innocence and ignorance, there are possibilities because of lack of their staunchness, they will be affected by the third principle, temptation. And it is the duty of the government or any government-oriented serving industry. So media is one of the fourth estate. Even though it may be an education-oriented entertainment known as edutainment, recreation-oriented entertainment known as a recreantment, spiritual orientation entertainment known as spritainment, information-oriented entertainment known as infotainment, whatever may be the type of entertainment that it makes. But still it is having a bounded duty of the system or rule of the land that it must see the two things. One, temptation must not be created. Tempting the person to go towards the practice of anything prohibited by the rule of land must not be there. And anybody who is doing the temptation, guiding, supporting, hiding these things, they will be punished. They will be the supportive tools of these malfunctionings. Moreover, punishment is also there. So there are two types of rigidity. First type of rigidity is preventional rigidity, to prevent these things from coming into contact, because informations cannot be prevented. To prevent these things from functioning with contact, that is to establish shops, manufacturing units, distributions, stockage and other things have to be prevented. And second thing, if they are found that they have to be severely punished, not only the users. The users are always considered as victims, and these fellows who utilize, market the temptations of society, they are known as victimizers. The victimizers are always, they are blown with a punishment tool, and the victims are always sympathetically viewed by the government. Even in prostitution, the women being a weaker sex and being the tool of the possibility of suppression or being misled by the temptation and surroundings and the coercion, these women, they are always sympathetically concerned by the rule of prostitutional law and the illicit trafficking and immoral trafficking and adultery and various these types of laws. They pay a wave of sympathy towards these people as victims, and the persons who are doing the brokerage and indulging these people in such activities, they are utilizing the temptation. They are either tempting the persons who are untempted or utilizing the temptations already available, boosting the temptations by additional gadgets. These three types of major things are done by these people. So the rule of land, it punishes everybody universally throughout the place. Likewise, if like ice cream, chocolate, etc., which are selectively prohibited, which they are circumstantially prohibited, which they are quantitatively prohibited, a reasonable dosage of a decent dance, entertainment, all of these things are very much there. It is a momentary pressure that won't root inside the mind, which will tempt them to go into obscenity, indecency, vulgarity and violence. It won't do that. So there is a dosage. For example, if you sleep, want to sleep, you are taking a sleeping pill. And if you take the pills more, then you sleep, you will have a permanent sleep. You will sleep into eternity. So there is a dosage. So quantitative, selective and circumstantial prohibitions are there for consumable elements, and totally prohibited elements like heroin, all of these things are there. So violence and vulgarity, showing these things to a greater extent, is absolutely prohibited. And no doubt, in a show of war, or in a domestic violence, or in a story in which there is a compulsory ground where the person, the heroine, is a dancer, certainly she has to dance. If it makes the story, see, making a story as per your desire is entirely different from framing a story as per its course. So if you plan, pre-plan that you must do at least 5 dances you must show in that film, if you pre-plan and pre-distinct and lead the story as per that, if you are just stitching your feet as per the size of the slippers in cinema industry or in screenplay, then we cannot help. If there is a necessity in the characteristic affirmation or framework, in restoring the characteristic beauty of a character, of a person, no doubt we can add towards a decent dosage. And these type of things can be permitted with a drugstore or a grocery store, which cannot be compared with that of a mother, which need not be compared, etc., which can be also commercialized. But commercialization of the pernicious temptations, either create a temptation, guide a temptation, or boosting a temptation and victimizing the society, is very much prohibited. So you must understand the society, the level of the people in the society, and you must market things as per that level of apprehension. You see, if there is a lamp like this, you can be very safe if grown people like us, if we are sitting. If there is somebody mentally retarded, if there is a crawling infant, certainly either you will keep this away from that or you will keep the child away from this. Because you know how it is. Mentally retarded, that is immature. And the child is ungrown. Likewise, most of the people are governed by innocence, ignorance and temptation in the society. The unlearned people, they are between innocence, shuffling between innocence and ignorance. Even the learned society is governed by temptations. So with this immature society, it is very, very risky for us to develop temptation-oriented marketing in cinema industry, which is not only it is degradable to a mother status, but also to a angadi status, a grocery shop status. It is going to an underworld world. It is going to an underworld where there is practice of adultery and drug trading and immoral trafficking. That type of industry or commercialization can be never entertained and engaged.